This is the Brett Snodgrass Podcast. Thank you guys for joining me today. I got a good buddy and real estate investor, one of the best in the world, Chris Craddock with the Reddix Group. He's going to be on a little bit later. But first, go over to YouTube and smash that subscription button and tickle that like button so you get all the videos that come out each and every week. Chris Craddock, guys, he is a certified life coach and leadership, one of the top real estate professionals in the world, closing 30 to 65 deals a month. He's a host of the Uncommon Real Estate Podcast, a realtor, an entrepreneur, a dad of six, a husband. He's building a beautiful house, lives in the D.C. area, and he is a man of Christ. But before real estate, he was working on staff at Young Life and a pastor. We're going to dig into the uncut scripting of who is Chris Craddock. What's going on, buddy?
Hey, brother. Glad to be here with you.
Yeah, man. I'm super excited. Chris and I go way back. We've been part of a groups together, the Multipliers together, and I've had him on a podcast before when I was doing Real Estate with a Purpose podcast, and here we are again. Chris Craddock, thanks for being on the show, man. I always look forward to talking to you. The energy. I'm feeling the energy come through the camera right now, so appreciate it, man.
Happy to be here, man. Happy to be here. Thank you. Yes. Thanks for the invite. Every time I get a chance to hang with you, I'm excited about it.
No, sounds good, man. Well, I just always start off with this very first question, and we go deep right away. And the first question I always ask everybody is this: who is Chris Craddock?
Oh, man. That's a great question. So I guess if I were to break it down, a couple things. I'm a Christian guy. So, you know, I think that's, you know, when I define my identity, I think that's one. Number two, I've got a great family, you know, married 21 years, six kids. Which is insane, but shows, you know, I'm a go big or go home kind of guy. So, you know, why stop at one or two? Right. Six kids. And then, business wise, I started off through flipping houses. Then I'd been in ministry forever, and I flipped houses to essentially afford to live while being in ministry. And then, I'd gone back to school, got a doctorate in leadership, always led large groups of people, love leading, large groups of people. And so, ended up building out a retail real estate team, and then, built out a number of other businesses. So now, I run 11 businesses, or I have 11 businesses that are, I don't necessarily run, but I'm a part owner of. And it's just been really fun. So, I mean, if I break it down, you know, God, family, business is kind of what I'm all about. And, you know, as you get to know me, you'll know, like, I like to have a lot of fun, work hard, play hard. I'm at a conference right now, as you can tell by the hotel here in Tampa. You can probably see the stadium right there in the background. Love, work hard, play hard. That's kind of, you know, what I love to do.
Yeah, man. That's what I think about you too. Go big or go home. Six kids, married 21 years, 11 businesses. It's like, you know, building a house right now during this crazy time and this massive house. And that's just awesome, man. But that's what I think about you. Go big or go home. Businessman, investor, coach, entrepreneur, family man, man of Christ, husband. And I just want to kind of pull back the curtains. That's what I like to do on the show. Go a little bit real and raw. And so you've been a businessman for many years now, but take us before that. I love your story. You worked with Young Life. You were a pastor for a church. I want to know, what was Chris Craddock like before real estate?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I'll tell you, the crazy thing was, my family, they loved me when I was a kid, but man, they had a lot of baggage as well, like almost everybody. And so, I mean, I just, you know, I acted out like, I, as you can tell, I'm a high energy guy. And so, my high energy ended up being just crazy with all the stuff that, I kind of got into, to kind of, just because I didn't know where my life was headed. I didn't know how to find, you know, fulfillment and peace and joy. And so I was looking for it in all the wrong places. And, literally as an eighth grader selling drugs, you know, just, I mean, I was an entrepreneur from the beginning, right? You know, making money, but doing like crazy stuff. I mean, literally, oh man, bro, I could tell you, like, I'll just tell you one little brief part of the story. You know, my best friend and I, his dad was an FBI agent. So he sat at a desk. He didn't go out in the field. So we ended up selling his gun from his bag for $300 to buy stuff that then sell at our school.
To buy drugs.
Buy drugs. Yeah. Then we could then sell at our school. And anyway, long story short was, thank the Lord, you know, I got out of that. But yeah, it ended with a bunch of FBI agents on Easter morning banging on my front door. But, you know, I met the Lord through Young Life. So my life became different. I became a Christian through Young Life, which was just incredible. And then I had some great Young Life leaders that taught me what it was to be a man, taught me what it was to, to be who I was created to be. It made such an impact for me that when I got married, I wanted to go on staff with Young Life and do that for other people. I've always loved to coach. I've always loved to help people. And when I get excited about something, if you've ever read much Malcolm Gladwell, like if I'm excited about something, I need to tell everybody else about it. Like, I can't help it. And so I got excited about Jesus. So I want to tell everybody about Jesus. I still am. So I went on staff with Young Life, loved it. 2003, my wife got pregnant. I was making about 20 grand a year in the DC area, which makes it really hard to live. With 20,000 a year, my wife, it was really cool. She was a ghostwriter for, if you're familiar with Prison Fellowship or Chuck Colson, she was Chuck Colson's ghostwriter. She actually just like wrote some stuff and literally as like an intern, all of a sudden, like Chuck showed up in this big organization and was like, where's the girl that wrote that letter? Like essentially just brought her out. And, you know, there's a verse in the Bible that says, you see a person skilled in their work, they're going to stand before kings, not obscure men. And it was just one of those things where she just did a great job. And so Chuck found her and picked her out and said, you're going to write for me now. And so it was kind of funny, like Chuck Colson, a Christian celebrity of our era, would call our landline and I'd pick up and I'm like, oh my gosh, this is crazy. But then, you know, she was, we wanted her to stay home with the kids. So 20,000 a year wasn't working. So I went to, I started flipping houses. I made 12 times what I made in a year in about 4 months. And, you know, then I used that money and went back to just continuing to be able to do ministry. And after, after a while, I guess, you know, the money started running out as I had more kids, started flipping houses again, I think in 2011. And at that point, all the way that I used to go to flip houses, they were all short sales because it was after the crash. And so in the past, you just look for the best price you could get. Now it was like, you know, the bank was going to pay a commission to a real estate agent. So I got my real estate license just to get paid a commission when I bought my own short sales to flip my own short sales. And then during that time, I guess somebody had given me Gary Keller's Millionaire Real Estate Agent book. And I love Color by Numbers. I think that that's where things should go. You know, I've heard this, like, you know, when you look at teaching, it's not about, you shouldn't be pushing education. You should be pushing instruction. Like, what is the next thing? What is the next thing? Like, what's your color by numbers? And I love that book because it was Color by Numbers. And I was like, I can do this. This is great. And it just through a number of processes kind of was led to do that. And we launched our real estate team December 2014. It was like, it's been like a rocket ship. And I say that, but I also, man, I've had so many things that were like terrible and rough and hard, but yeah. Anyway, that's what brings us to today.
Yeah. Yeah. No, thank you for sharing that story. That's number one, amazing. And since 2014, you have led your team 11 businesses now, but your main business, I think, is the Reddix Group, the real estate brokerage, doing hundreds of deals a year, one of the top real estate professional companies in the world. You know, and that's just amazing. And I want to just get back to just kind of comparing a little bit of leading Young Life, being a pastor. You got into real estate to make money, to pay the bills, to make ends meet with your wife and your family now. But let's just talk about, it's all kind of very similar as far as, I don't think that leading a group as a pastor versus a real estate team. Talk about the comparisons and differences, because to me, it sounds like it's very similar. Like, you lead teams, you lead groups of people. And I want people to kind of like just hone in on that a little bit.
Yeah. Well, I'll start with like when I started the team. So to build a good business, your business should earn the right to build out its org chart, right? You either have time or money. And a lot of times, I think one of the biggest problems with people in business is they just spend money on things and they haven't earned the right to build out the org chart yet because they don't understand it. And then they lose a bunch of money. So for me, the way I earned the right to build out the org chart was I started doing a lot of deals myself and then took the money that I made and then started hiring people with that. And so I started off literally, I had heard in residential real estate, people said, hey, call your sphere of influence, call people that already know, like, and trust you. And, you know, if they already know, like, and trust you, they'll trust you with a decision like this. And so I thought about it. And when I was in ministry, what I would do is I had my most rudimentary, I didn't even know what a CRM stood for or what a CRM was. So I had my own rudimentary CRM, which was my phone and my contacts on it. And so I literally, on days that I just didn't have much going on in ministry, I would just start with A's and I would just call all my A's and just be like, Alan. Hey, Alan, how you doing? This is Chris Craddock. Hey, I just want to call, see if there's anything I could do for you. Could I pray for you? Is there anything in your life going on that, you know, just what's going on, and just have a conversation. And so it was just interesting when I got into it and they said, talk to your sphere of influence. I just started doing that, just calling and just saying, hey, is there anything I can do for you? Anything, you know, ask people if I can pray for them still and all of that. And people just would, it was funny. There's a law of reciprocity. If you ask people about their life, they're going to ask you about your life. And so I shared what I was doing. And a lot of people are like, oh, I know somebody looking to buy a house. Can I connect you? You know, or I'm thinking about buying or selling a house. And so that built that out. And then, the cool thing was, I ended up praying for people almost as much as I did when I was in ministry, you know, because people were making like some of the biggest decisions of their life, right? Like buying a house, selling a house is some of the most important decisions you'll make in your entire life. So, and a lot of times people started calling me, like if they're going through a divorce or financial hardship or other stuff. And so I could just talk real life with them, you know, because that's what I've been doing my whole life. And so that was cool. And then when I brought on people, you know, my clients ended up, not being the people buying and selling the houses. My clients ended up being my staff, right? So, instead of calling clients and instead of calling just my sphere of influence all the time, I was also calling my staff and my agents and the people that worked for me, just asking them, how can I serve you? How can I pray for you? How can I, you know, all the other stuff. And, you know, I one of the habits Brandon Burchard talks about in high performance habits is that a high performer imparts energy into what they do. And so that to me was one of the things that I saw myself doing, was like, how do I impart life? How do I impart energy into the people in my world, right? If I'm going to be a good leader, I need to do that for them. And so that was just kind of the same stuff that I did in ministry with my volunteer teams. I just started doing with my teams in business is, you know, how can I impart, you know, life into them, and how can I encourage them? How can I help them see life bigger? How can I, you know, see the better version of themselves than maybe they see for themselves?
Yeah. No, I love that, because again, you're just talking about this people business and you're really, really good with people. And like, just even the having this, you give life to people, you give the energy, and you're great on the phone. I know you have courses and you talk on YouTube channels and videos about talking on the phone. You've been taking these long walks. Sometimes I think one of your practices is you take a 15-mile walk and call 50 people, and that's just so good. But again, it's not like you have something to sell. You just call and say, hey, how can I help you? How can I serve you? And that's a great leader, because you did that with your clients at first, then you had this team and you're doing that with him. What are some other things that you do with your team to build the culture, to pour into them? And is there some other things that you do, as far as rhythms in your business to pour into your team?
Yeah. So one of the things is when I wake up in the morning, so I was honored, you know, we ended up moving over to eXp Realty, which I love, but I was with Keller Williams for so long. And I was just so blessed to be able to have Gary Keller, you know, be in his small group of top agents at Keller Williams, and have him, you know, just learn from him. I think he's one of the smartest people in real estate. And one of the things that he said was, if you stop growing, the high performers in your world are going to outgrow you and they're going to leave your world. They'll still be friends with you, but they're going to leave your world. And so one of the things that I've done is just in the mornings, I wake up and I think I work to dream bigger, right? And I'll give an example of this. So one of my buddies, he makes a lot. I mean, he makes like $500,000 a year in real estate, which is, it's where he wants to be, right? He doesn't want to dream any bigger. Like, that's a good number, like across the board, right? Oh, nobody will say that's a bad number, right? That's a good number, right? And so, so I was talking to him about like growing and getting bigger and, you know, kind of going next level. And he was like, Chris, I'm totally happy with where I'm at. And what I said to him, I was like, hey, I get that. I totally understand. But here's my pushback to you. Is everybody in your organization happy with where they're at? And he's like, well, I mean, I think they'd all like to make a little bit more money, all the other stuff. And I said, well, if you stop growing, then their world stops where your world is right now. And they're not going to be able to grow. And so the way that Gary Keller pushed it, put it to me, and the way that I see it in my own life is that I've got to wake up every morning and I owe it to my people to continue to grow, because as I grow, it's like a fish in a fishbowl. The bigger the bowl, the bigger the fish can get. And so I owe it to my people to grow and see opportunities, because as I see opportunities, it allows them to grow and see opportunities themselves. And it reminds me of the other thing too is, like, I look at my people and I see, you know, I boiled down the way, like, my genius zones. And one of those things is being able to pitch vision and help people see vision. I think that's part of my genius zone, the thing that I'm really good at in the world. And one of the things for vision is I can look at my people and say, here's where you can become a better version of yourself. And I spend time thinking about it. I pray for my people. I think about them and how they can level up in their own life. So one, I've got to level up myself so that their fish tank gets bigger. But two, I need to be able to see in them things they don't see. And I mean, everybody's heard this before, but I'm just going to say it, even though it's a little bit cliche now. But as a leader, part of vision is like when Michelangelo created his sculpture of David, right? They said, how did you envision this? Like, what did you do? And he's like, well, I just saw what it needed to look like. And I chipped away the pieces that weren't supposed to be there. And that's what was left. And I think as a leader, that's what we need to do. We need to be able to envision what the people that that work for us should and could become, and then help them chip away the pieces so that they become that masterpiece.
Yeah. Oh, man, I love that. I've just taken notes here because I stepped out of my business about 15 months ago as kind of the owner, but I was always a visionary, always growing, always pouring into my people. And I've kind of was like what you're describing this other guy as, is like, I feel like I'm good and I haven't been pouring into my people as much. And it's just kind of a convicting thing because, again, and not all growth is measured in numbers, right? So like, I might be good with my numbers, but are all the people good with where they're at? And that's where I get the most fulfillment, if I can pour into my people. So I'm convicted just by that statement. Thanks so much for that nugget. I want to just dive in. So we talked about team, talked about culture, leadership. This is all about leadership, guys, on how to build this team, how to build this culture. And obviously, you said that you've had some challenges, obviously, in business, and there's challenges in ministry as well. But I want to ask you just kind of like a personal question. What has been the most challenging, do you think? Was it being a young life on staff there, being a pastor, or like leading this business in the secular world?
Well, I'll tell you, it's tough. So it's funny. One of my mentors said this to me, and there's so much truth to it, is that you should never trust someone that doesn't walk with a limp. And I was like, okay, yeah, that makes sense. I would say probably the most challenging time was after I got back into real estate investing. It was crazy because I had so much success right away. I made a ton of money in 2011, 2012, like a ton of money. And Jim Collins defines it in his book, How the Mighty Fall, says one of the reasons why the mighty fall is because of the hubris born of success. And that happened to me. Mm-hmm. I made so much money and it was so great. And that sounds so douchey until you hear the rest of the story, right? Which here's the rest of the story. I thought that anything I touched would turn to gold. And so I ended up just, I kept finding good deals and I bought the next one all of a sudden. And then I didn't have enough money to continue buying, but there were such good deals. I was going to friends and family and just borrowing money and going to the bank and leveraging everything. And the promise that I made my wife, which is our house would never be at risk, was, you know, I broke that promise like so many times over. And then all of a sudden I realized we were buying a rental property and I had to turn in a financial statement. And my wife called me and she's like, Chris, have you looked at the P&L? And I was like, yeah, we're good. I think we got like 300 grand in the bank to, you know, for everything. And she's like, when's the next property sell? And I was like, I made a call to our contractor, and we did these bigger projects like in DC that took a long time. And the next one was like 6 months away. And she's like, what's our overhead monthly? And all of a sudden I realized, I'm like, oh crap, about 150 grand, 300 grand in the bank. Next sale is 6 months away. And so I'll tell you what, I mean, all of a sudden I got really, really like, I mean, my hair was falling out, and I was grinding my teeth at night. I couldn't sleep, and it was rough. I did everything. I mean, it was probably the most creative I've ever been to solve that problem. And I still remember there was a video, which I think everybody should watch if you get a chance. It's a cheesy video from the 80s, but it's Art Williams, Just Do It. It's 18 minutes. He's talking to the national religious broadcasters about winning in business. So it's not a Christian talk, but it does come from that worldview. But one of the things he was just talking about is like, hey, no matter what's going on, just get out there and do it. And, and honestly, like when I realized the mess I'd gotten myself into, the fact that, I mean, literally I'm like, if we don't solve this, my family, everything I've worked for all these years, like we're going bankrupt. Like, yeah. Like that's it. Like we don't have the money to do it. But what was worse than that is I borrowed so much money from family and friends. And so to me, like going bankrupt and not paying them back was not ever an option. Like, these were people that trusted me. It's not like a bank that's some institution. These are like my friends and family. So I'm like, not only would I go bankrupt for the bank, but then I'd have years and years because it was just like, I have to pay these people back.
Yeah.
And so, like the crazy thing is like, we worked so hard. I mean, I was doing like owner financing where other people were handling stuff, which is like the worst thing that you never want to be the one doing the owner financing, you know, in that situation. And so, but I just had to do it. And thankfully somehow we got out of that mess. But it taught me so much. And actually the crazy thing is, there's a verse in the Bible where David, after they went to war, they came back, and it's where he was in Ziklag was where it was. And basically some army had come in and basically raided their camp, took their families, took their kids, made them slaves, you know, just took everything they had. So they came back from fighting this battle, and all the men were so tired. And it said that they literally thought about stoning David, their leader, the person that had led them. And David said he went alone and encouraged himself in the Lord. And I remember that feeling and getting through that. Well, then when COVID happened last year, and I have a pretty big overhead now, I mean, it's back to almost 150,000 a month. And I thought, man, if I don't sell any houses, if nothing sells, my title company, my like any of that other stuff doesn't get paid, I've got all these people to pay. And I started freaking out for a second. But the crazy thing is, I remembered back to that time, and I was like, man, you know, if God got me through that last one, he's going to get me through this. Like I'm still standing after that. And so anyway, some people say, what would you do differently? I mean, I would love to say I would do stuff differently, but I'm also so thankful because that pain has shaped me into the business leader and the man that I am today.
Yeah. And sometimes it's good to have your back against a wall like that. And especially, I mean, I know that feeling when you, not only are you raising up your own family, but you're also responsible for these other people's money as well. And that's like, I know for me, like I want to take care of their money far more than my own money in my bank. And I think you're the same way, Chris. So I would just say, like, if one of our listeners, they're back against the wall right now, I'd say sometimes that's a good spot to be in because it helps you be creative and helps you problem solve your situation. And then when you're again later in life with whatever situation you're in and your back is against the wall again, it can also help you out. So you can remember back to that time.
And if your back is against the wall, go watch that YouTube video and
that's
just
right.
Google Art Williams to do it. I'll tell you, like literally, I can tell you without a doubt, like there was a shift that happened in our life because I watched that video. Then I brought my wife in and I said, Catherine, watch this. And she was crying. I mean, it was rough because of the situation I got us into, full ownership in this. And I had her watch the video, and literally we watched the video, we got down on our knees and we prayed and said, God, just give us the strength to get out of this. Give us the wisdom to do the right thing. And we got up and literally it was go time. That like, it like steeled my soul. So if anybody's in that place right now, go watch that video. pray and ask God for some help and then go just do it. Make it happen.
I love that. I love that. I want to ask you just real quick. So you take yourself back. You were making no money, 20K a year. To now, I've seen you're building this amazing house now. It sounds like you're doing really, really well for yourself. And so you're on this other side. You're living with abundance. You have a lot, and you used to have little. So can you tell what is the feeling like? Because some people like to know, some people watching this, they don't have a lot of money. And I just like to ask people that have been on both sides of that, what is that like? And are you different? Is, you know, talk to us about your life with abundance versus little.
The joke I love to share is like in 2010, you know, cause the money had started running out. Like I was like, I'm right near NIH. I was trying to go to NIH cause they were paying $300 if you sell your blood. I'm like trying to pay 300, like get $300 to buy Christmas presents for my family by selling my blood. And now, you know, obviously, like you said, I'm on the other side of that and just massively blessed. As far as where things are, I mean, I was blessed then too. So don't let me, money doesn't decide whether you're blessed or not. But I will say this, you know, I'm actually preaching a sermon at our church on finances in a couple of weeks. And, you know, as I was sitting there working on it, one of the things that I found was when we had very little, we gave first, you know, like, so we're giving out of our poverty or out of our abundance. Like we were always giving, we were always generous. We were always making sure that we were getting like that was important to us. You know, there were some things that we didn't have the ability to do that we do now, but we were faithful with that money. We weren't putting money on credit cards. We would just tighten our belt and live within our means. We didn't act like the government where we just find ways to like, you know, we could spend whatever we want. Like, honestly, I mean, we'd live on ramen noodles. Like my wife still, I think she's still a little bit bitter about this, but you know, she needed to buy a dog brush. Well, we didn't have the money to do it. So like literally she was counting out change from our change drawer to buy a dog brush. And so, like, she still jokes about how bitter she is about that, but it was really good. Actually, one of my favorite stories too was we didn't turn on heat and AC when we had no money. And I still remember one, it was like in December, Catherine comes down in a hoodie and with her like blankets. And she's like, "Hey, Chris, I think heat is worth paying for."
That's okay.
Fine. We can turn on the heat. But the reality is we worked hard to live within our means and we always put aside money for investing, right? We put aside money. We put aside money to give. We put aside money for savings. We put aside money for investing, even when we made no money, right? And so there's a verse in the Bible that says the person that's faithful with little will be faithful with much, right? And so, and also you see, again, I'm preaching a sermon, so I hope it's all right that I have got a, you know, in the parable of the talents, you know, Jesus talks about that. And the person that's faithful with little will be faithful with much, but also will be given much, right? So you'll be given even more. So, you know, the person that has will be given more. And so a lot of times people get upset with like the disparity of wealth. And I think some of that's part of the government stuff, but like making it harder, you know, on people when they're trying to help, it always hurts. Mm-hmm. But what happened is when, you know, if you're good with what you're good with, it's, you know, you're going to get more. So that's the piece there. And, you know, even when we had, and this is the other side, I'm sorry, I'm like jumping around a little bit, but this is the other side. If you're not faithful with it, if you have very little, I'm telling you, inside your head, you're going to tell yourself a story that's not a true story. Mm-hmm. That you'll say, you know what, when I have more money, I'll do the right thing. I'll give more, I'll save more, I'll invest more. But if you're not good with it, when you don't have much, you're just going to move the goalpost because there's more things that you can spend money on, nicer cars, you know, bigger houses, all these other things. And so from the very beginning, we spent all of our stuff was out of our excess. I drive nice cars now and I'm building a really nice house, but that's all out of excess. I'm not going into debt for that, right? And because we decided from the very beginning that these were the principles that we live within. And then it helped us, you know, with now where we have more. And the great thing is, I mean, we're able to do a lot with our giving. We're able to help a lot of people, you know, because we've been entrusted with a lot more now.
Yeah. Yeah, and that just brings you to this point. Again, just kind of taking yourself back. So when I look at you, you're married to Catherine, six kids, entrepreneur, wonderful dad, husband, and I don't stalk you, but I watch you from afar. And you've said this before, I think on the last podcast, is like you have this success platform, but you also have it for a reason, because I was listening to a keynote speaker, Jeff Hoffman, a few weeks ago, and he talked about the success. If you're successful, it gives you this platform that you didn't have before. So I want to ask you, like, you have this platform now, you are successful, you can talk into people's lives a little bit differently than you did before. Obviously, you're giving this sermon on finances, and you have a little bit of a different perspective now than what you did when you're only making $20,000 a year. So what is it that you want to use your success platform for?
Yeah, well, I mean, I'd say legacy is one of the things, you know, for my family and then also for organizations that we care about. It's so funny. My wife was the oldest of nine, a pastor's daughter, had no money and just doesn't care about money that much. And I still remember she came down the stairs one day and she was like, kind of teared up a little bit. And she's like, "Chris, I need you to make more money." And I was like, who is this? what is going on with my wife? But she had just been reading the Young Life magazine about this guy that donated to Young Life Camp. And she's like, "I'd love to donate a camp. I'd love to do something that is like makes massive impact for generations." And and it reminded me of a story of a Young Life, of the guy that donated Young Life's Lake Saranac. And I was at this, you know, fundraising event, and they brought him in and he told his story. He was a business guy. He sold his business. And he's like, "When I sold my business, I did three things. I bought a jet, I bought a yacht, and I bought Young Life Saranac." And I said, "The jet, probably a scrapyard somewhere. I got no idea where it is. The yacht, probably at the bottom of the ocean. I have no idea." He's like, "But Young Life Saranac, you know, hundreds of thousands of teenagers have heard about Jesus Christ and had their lives changed because of that. So if I had to do it over again, I'd buy three Young Life camps." And I was like, "Dang, that's powerful."
Yeah. That's awesome. Yes. And I feel like that you're doing that. You're building this house, and to look at it, it's a big house. You're in the process right now, but you had a vision for your home. I was talking to you and Catherine. We were at this retreat, and you kind of have this vision. You're building not only the house, but you're building a bunkhouse. You want to host different things. So talk to us about like your vision of this new home.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you, one of the things that cost me a lot of money was the fact that I'm in real estate. I should be able to read plans better. And so we go into the basement, and the basement, one of the things we said to the architect is we need to be able to have 300 kids butt to butt in this room so we can have all county Young Life here. Like that was one of our dreams. And we go in and the room was just not big. Like it was like segmented too much. So, oh man, like literally they had just laid the concrete and put up the framing. So it literally cost us 10 grand to redo everything and put it out there, which was painful. But yeah, that's one of the things there. We have a bunkhouse so that people can come in that are our friends from all over the place in the DC area, stay with us there. My wife's always wanted to do horses. And so, being able to have the horses there, she actually created a room, like it's called the salon, which is like the French, salon, which is kind of the idea, like our idea is that we're friends with a lot of people that are, world-class thinkers, and that they would be able to come in and just like, we could invite like 10 people over and just have a topic. Like one of my buddies, anytime like Korea is on the news, right? I'm in the DC area, right? Anytime something's going on in Korea, he's like literally all over the news everywhere. He's like the person they call. He's a world expert. So he can come in and like talk about Korea and what's going on there, right? And just be able to exchange ideas. Or if somebody wants to argue about, you know, any of these, should you get vaccinated? Should you not get vaccinated? Yeah, right? Like, which yeah. I know is like this topic Jeez. That's making people freak out. But like that should be a conversation that people should be able to have. So that's one of the rooms that Catherine created, this like the salon. you know, based on that idea of, you know, a place where people could exchange ideas and not hate each other if you disagree.
Yeah. So that's awesome. That's awesome. Well, I look forward to seeing the pictures when that is completed. And I know my wife and family would love to come out and visit DC area when you guys get that finished and stay in the bunkhouse. Look forward to that. Chris, we're about out of time, man. Thank you so much for your time today. I want to give you also the opportunity to, you help a lot of people, especially real estate agents and real estate investors. You coach, you have a couple of things going on that really help link. I mean, I know you as this amazing real estate broker, this brokerage company, and you help link brokers or agents to investors. Talk to us about that a little bit, what you're doing there.
Yeah. So I've got something called REI Revive, and you can go to my website, chriscraddick.com. And the whole idea is that if you are an investor, you're going to be paying for leads of people that are wanting to sell their house at a discount, right? So if 20 people call in from your marketing, of them, maybe four want to sell at a discount, right? And then of the four, maybe you lock up one. So there's 19 people that have raised their hand and said, yes, I want to sell. But the problem is, you know, the other 19, they don't fit in your buy box, or they're not going to be stuff sold to you. So like they just lie dead in your CRM. So what happens with those 19? Somebody else is making money and it's just not you. So so what we've done is teach people how to partner with real estate agents to monetize those deals. And I'll tell you, a lot of times people just say, oh, that's a great idea, I'm going to just start sending deals to real estate agents. Well, that's been tried by everybody. Talk to anybody that's done business for a while. They send them over to real estate agents, and it's more shocking when you get paid than when you don't get paid, because there's a reason people called investors. So instead of an agent, right? They want to talk to a certain person about a certain way of selling their house. And so we work on scripts, dialogues, the ability to actually crack the code with these leads and monetize them at a massive level. Heck, we've got one of our groups that we send like an average of around $60,000 a month to in referral fees for leads that were just sitting dead in their CRM. Like that's real money. And so if you're an investor or a wholesaler or anybody like that, I'll just tell you, you're leaving money in your database if you're not getting paid like crazy all the time by real estate agents. And there's a code that really can be cracked here for you that you can monetize those deals.
That's awesome. Check that out, guys. I know I've checked it out. It's at chriscraddick.com, REI Revive. Right, Chris?
Yes, sir.
So check that out. If you're an investor or an agent and you want to learn how to link those two together, everything is a blueprint right there for you. Chris, thank you so much for being on the Brett Snodgrass podcast. I'm going to end this show with a little fire round. So I have basically four questions for you. Name the first thing that comes to your mind on these responses. Number one, best book recently read?
Oh, man. Good Strategy, Bad Strategy. It's incredible. It just makes you realize, like, my go-to is always work harder. And the whole idea is work harder will get you to a certain place. But, you know, if you want to go high level, it's about strategy, not just more effort.
Yeah. I love that. Podcast that you listen to. Do you listen to a podcast?
Yeah, I listen to a ton of them. You know, the Craig Groeschel Leadership Podcast is my favorite one that I've been listening to recently.
Cool. What would you write a book on?
I've got a couple different ones that I've actually written ideas on. I love the idea of the corporate athlete. Just the reality is, what makes people winners in sports will tend to make you a winner in the corporate world.
Awesome. Sounds good. All right. Last one. I'm going to switch up a little bit. So people talk about BHAG in their business. So this big, hairy, audacious goal in their business 10, 30 years from now. I like to talk about your BHAG in your life. What is that for you? What's like your big, hairy, audacious goal? 30 years from now, you can look back. What is a summary of Chris Craddick's life?
Man, that I, you know, that I was, you know, a faithful follower of Jesus, that I raised an amazing family who are all, like, all my kids are successful and, you know, just kicking butt, great marriages, and that I have a business that that I'm proud of, where I've changed the lives of hundreds, if not thousands, of people through the businesses that we've created.
Awesome. Sounds good. Well, I hope that you achieve that, Chris Craddick. This is a wrap. Brett Snodgrass podcast. Thank you so much, buddy, for being on the podcast today. Appreciate it.
No worries. And can I throw this out there? If one of the things people did for me was been open to it. So if anybody reaches out to me on Instagram at Crad Rock, You know, just I'll be willing to answer any DMs or anything like that. People were so great with me on that. So if anybody wants to reach out to me on Instagram, I'll answer any DMs that you send me.
Sounds good. We're going to put Crad Rock Instagram on our description on the Brett Snodgrass YouTube channel. That's a wrap. Thanks, Chris Craddock. Appreciate you, man.
Thanks, brother. This is awesome.
Thank you so much for checking out the Brett Snodgrass channel. If you like this video, please slam on that like button. And if you really like it, then subscribe to our channel here. And remember to leave us a comment below, and I'm going to try my hardest to reply to all the comments. Thank you guys so much. This is why I do what I do. Every single week, I come out with content that focuses on success, freedom, and living out your purpose. Thank you guys so much. See you next time.